Good morning to those of you who are here in church and to those of you watching online. Thank you for joining us as we celebrate the 12th Sunday in ordinary time. In every human life, there are occasional storms, challenges, and difficulties that bring disorder and cause us suffering. As today's first reading and gospel reminds us, God has power over the storms of our lives. But more than that, God can actually use these storms to help us reorder our lives and our priorities, mature as human beings, and grow in our faith. Our faithful God will always be with us and bring us through whatever difficulty we face. As God's word in the Bible assures us, all things work for good for those who love God. Please remember to silence your cell phones so that we can worship God without distraction. Thank you. The celebrant for these Mass is Father Francis, and the preacher is Father Roberto.
Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting. For you never deprive of your guidance those who set firm on whom you set firm on the foundation of your love. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Job. The Lord addressed Job out of the storm and said, "Who shut the big doors, the sea, when it burst forth from the womb, when I made the clouds its garment, and thick darkness its swaddling bands, when I set limits for it, and fastened the bar of each door, and said, thus far shall you come, but no farther, and here shall your pathways be still." The word of the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord. His love is everlasting. They who sailed the sea in ships, trading on the deep waters, these saw the works of the Lord and his wonders in the abyss. His command raised up a storm wind, which tossed its waves on high. They mounted up to heaven. They sank to the depths. Their hearts melted away in their flight. They cried to the Lord in their distress. From their straits he rescued them. He hushed the storm to a gentle breeze, and the billows of the sea were still. They rejoiced that they were calm, and he brought them to their desired haven. Let them give thanks to the Lord for his kindness and his wondrous deeds to the children of men. A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, the love of Christ impels us. Once we have come to the conviction that one died for all, therefore all have died. He indeed died for all, so that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. Consequently, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even if we once knew Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him, so no longer. So whoever is in Christ is a new creation. The old things have passed away. Behold, new things have come. The word of the Lord.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. And may the Word of God always be on our minds, on our lips, and in our hearts. On that day, as evening drew on, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let us cross to the other side." Leaving the crowd, they took Jesus with them in the boat just as he was, and other boats were with him. A violent squall came up, and waves were breaking over the boat so that it was already filling up. Jesus was in the stern, asleep on a cushion. They woke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up, rebuked the wind, and said to the sea, "Quiet, be still." The wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Then he asked them, "Why are you terrified? Do you not yet have faith?" They were so filled with great awe, they said to one another, "Who then is this, whom even wind and sea obey?" The Gospel of the Lord. Several years ago, there was a man who had a serious bout with cancer. He was married and had three children. And as you can imagine, it was a difficult time for him and for his family. However, later on, as he looked back on that experience, he had this to say, and I quote, "The cancer ended up being a blessing for me. Yes, it threw my life into chaos, robbed me of sleep, exhausted me, and took a terrible toll on my physical and emotional health. It also put a tremendous strain on my family, but it was a blessing because it helped me put my life in perspective. Things that used to worry me, for example, how much money I was making, the hassle at work, my wife's annoying habits, and my children's squabbling were no longer as important. I woke each day and began to see and appreciate the miracle of simply being alive. Now, I worry less about the future and live more in the present. The cancer helped me realize that I did not know if I was going to have a tomorrow, but I did know that I had it today. I was not going to let it slip through my fingers as I had most of my life." This man's powerful testimony of finding blessing even in the midst of difficulties is a great example of an essential process. An essential process that we all must go through in our lives if we want to mature as human beings as well as grow in our faith. And that essential process is this: order, disorder, and reorder. Order, disorder, reorder. So, for example, this man probably had a sense of order in his life, a sense of security and control where things were going along reasonably well for him. But there was something missing in his life, and he did not even know it. The reality was he was living a relatively superficial life, again, without even knowing. Then his cancer brought disorder to his life and suffering for him and for his family. But eventually, God used that experience, that difficult time, to help him reorder his life and his priorities. So in his life, order became disorder, which led to reorder at a deeper level. He reordered his life by letting go of his previous superficial sense of order, his previous understanding of who he was and what life was all about. He had to let that go. And that helped him come to a fuller and a richer life and a more mature faith. Order, disorder, we can see the same process in our gospel today. So at first, Jesus and his disciples are sailing along in the boats just fine. Everything is in order, just as it should be, smooth sailing. But then an unexpected storm comes up, waves are breaking over the boat, and the disciples panic. This disorder of chaos and fear causes them to lose faith in Jesus. And they cry out in despair, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" Finally, Jesus calms the storm. And by doing so, he astounds them so much that he begins to reorder their reality. Not only does he calm their fear, but he also invites them to a deeper place in their faith, where they begin to question their original and limited understanding of Jesus. They ask themselves, "Who is this? Well, even the wind and sea, who is this?" All of us go through this process of order, disorder, and reorder again and again and again in our lives. Like the disciples in the boat in today's gospel, we can be doing just fine in our lives, sailing along in calm waters, and these are the periods of time in our lives where we are in a certain comfort zone, where we feel safe because our beliefs, our attitudes, and our personal agenda are in order and in control, and everything seems to make pretty much good sense. But then all of a sudden, we are hit by a storm, like a pandemic, for example, or maybe problems in an important relationship in our lives, or we have health issues, or we lose a loved one, or we lose a job, or a home, or whatever it might be. We then enter into this period of disorder, where our world is turned upside down, where our beliefs, our attitudes, and our agenda are no longer working, and we have the feeling of being emotionally and spiritually tossed back and forth. Then, perhaps worst of all, our prayers go unanswered. Jesus seems to be asleep. He seems to be uninterested and even absent. And we cry out like the disciples today, "Where are you, Jesus? Do you not care that I am perishing, that we are perishing? Do something." How many times have we felt like that in our lives? Dozens, I would say, maybe even hundreds of times. But then, right at that moment, comes the moment of grace, a moment of decision where we have to choose, how are we going to react to that disorder in our lives? What are we going to do? Will we choose to flee, to run away from that disorder by denying it is even happening? "No problem, I'm fine, I'm okay." Or perhaps we run away by escaping into alcohol or drugs or work or some other addiction. Or perhaps we escape by attacking and getting angry with whoever we think is responsible for that disorder in our lives. Maybe our spouse, or some other loved one, or some other person, our boss. Or maybe the other political party that's taking our country to ruin. Maybe we get angry with life itself, or even with God. Will we choose those kinds of unhelpful and unhealthy responses? Or will we choose to accept the disorder, to accept it, and to learn from it, to learn what it has to teach us, and allow God to help us, to use that storm to help us reorder our lives and take us to a deeper understanding of ourselves, of life, and of God. That's what the man with cancer did in his life when he allowed the Lord to help him see his sickness as a blessing, not a curse. When he allowed the Lord to help him reorder his priorities and come to a whole new and better place in his life. And that is what the disciples in today's gospel did when they met Jesus, challenge them, reorder their image of him, and lead them into a deeper faith. My brothers and sisters, what I'm saying today is that our God has power. He has the power to use all things, especially the storms, the disorders, the sufferings in our lives. He can use them to help us mature as human beings, to help us grow in our faith through them. God is not just with us in the storm. He can actually use the storm to deepen our faith, to deepen our understanding of life. Now let me just quickly say here, as I've said before many times, God does not cause these bad things to happen in our lives. God does not will them. He does not use them or send them to us to punish us. No, that is not who God is. But God can use them to help us reorder our lives for the better. Now, on this Father's Day, I want to just speak to the fathers and father figures who are here for just a few moments, for those of you who are here, for those who are watching online. First of all, let me thank you for sacrificing yourselves so much to guide, protect, to provide for and serve your families and others. May God reward you for all your dedication and your goodness. But I also want to challenge you men to understand this process of order, disorder, and reorder, because part of your role as father figures is to be courageous, to be a courageous man who can face the disorder and challenges and suffering of life head on instead of running away from them or letting them make you angry or bitter. You must have to allow the sufferings of life to teach you patience, perseverance, wisdom, and humility. And then your role is to pass on that learning that you've gained at a price, to pass that on to your children, your grandchildren, your family, and all those who look up to you. That is your role. In other words, the challenge for you men is to be a real man. To be a real man by learning how to surrender to the Lord and by allowing him to mold you into being not just a man, but a man of God. So my brothers and sisters, all of us here, who want our life to be ordered, right? Who want to be life to be secure, to be comfortable, to be under our control? But you may know already that simply doesn't happen. Life is not like that. And neither is our faith. Now, please understand, we don't have to go around looking for disorder or suffering in our lives. It's going to happen no matter what. And when it does happen, that's our moment of decision, our moment of grace. When they do come our way, those terrible situations in our lives, We must choose to accept them. We don't like them, but we have to accept them and learn from them and let God use them to help us to reorder our lives, to mature as human beings, and to grow in our faith. Before I finish this morning, I just want to say a few words about our finances as a parish. Our finance committee has determined that over the last 15 months or so, we lost about 33%, a third of our income. That's a lot of money. So the parish is struggling. we are barely able right now to pay our bill. We don't have a whole lot of money left over. We need to ask you to be generous in the collection, not just today, but every time we come to Mass. What I would ask you to do is to give something significant in the collection. Again, not just today, but every time you come. Give something significant. And I would say for anybody over 5 years old, a dollar bill is not significant. So give something that you can say to God, Lord, I'm proud of what I'm giving to you. Because you're not giving it to me, you're not giving it to me, you're not giving it to the parish. You're giving it to God. So what can you give when you can say, this is something significant that I'm giving to you. So please, again, do what you can. We're heading through the summer, which is traditionally time to go on vacation, and so our collections tend to go down. So whatever you can do, especially if you can give electronically, so it's an automatic payment, so that we don't experience that letdown. Please give this.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from the true God, begotten not made, consubstantial of the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became a man. He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered the death and was buried, and rose again on the third of the day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We now come before God in the name of Jesus, who even wind and sea obey. Therefore, with humility and confidence, we offer our prayers.
For the grace to accept and learn from the storms in our lives, so that God can help us reorder our lives and our priorities, mature as human beings, and grow in faith, we pray to the Lord. For those who are experiencing difficulties and feel abandoned by God, may they soon experience God's strength and faithful love. We pray to the Lord. On this Father's Day, we pray for fathers and stepfathers, grandfathers and godfathers, and all men who serve young people as coaches and teachers, priests and counselors, for strength and tenderness, courage and wisdom, generosity and faithfulness. We pray to the Lord. For those who are suffering from the hot weather, especially the homeless, the poor, and the vulnerable, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For convenience, progress against the pandemic, especially in those regions that are struggling. We pray to the Lord.
Lord,
hear our prayers. For Jesus' silence, for the repose of his soul, whom we remember in a special way at this Mass, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all the intentions we hold in the silence of our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
God, you are our true Father, who loves each of us unconditionally and eternally. May we always know your love and walk in the light of your presence as your children. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Number 501. 501. Stand by me. Arranged the changing of the seasons
You formed us in your own image and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder. To rule in your name over all you have made and forever praise you in your mighty works through Christ our Lord. And so, with all the angels, we praise you as in joyful celebration we acclaim, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. We give you praise. We give you praise, Father most holy, for you are great, and you have fashioned all your works in wisdom and in love. You formed man in your own image and entrusted the whole world to his care, so that in serving you alone, the Creator, he might have dominion over all creatures. And when through disobedience we have lost your friendship, you did not abandon us to the domain of death. For you came in mercy to the aid of all, so that those who seek might find you. Time and again, you offered covenants, and through the prophets, you taught us to look forward to salvation. And you so loved the world, Father, most holy, that in the fullness of time, you sent your only begotten Son to be our Savior. Made incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, he shared our human nature in all things but sin. To the poor he proclaimed the good news of salvation, to prisoners freedom, and to the sorrowful of heart joy. To accomplish your plan, he gave himself up to death, and rising from the dead, he destroyed death and restored life. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose again for us, he sent the Holy Spirit from you, Father, as the first fruits for those who believe, so that bringing to perfection his work in the world, he might sanctify creation to the full. Therefore, O Lord, we pray, may the same Holy Spirit graciously sanctify these offerings, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ for the celebration of the great mystery which he himself left us as an eternal covenant. For when the hour had come for him to be glorified, by you, Father most holy, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And while they were at supper, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Taking the chalice filled with the fruit of the vine, he gave thanks and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. the mystery of faith. Save us, Savior of the world. For by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. Therefore, O Lord, as we now celebrate the memorial of our redemption, we remember Christ's death and his descent to the realm of the dead. We proclaim his resurrection and his ascension to your right hand. And as we await his coming in glory, we offer you his body and blood, the sacrifice acceptable to you, which brings salvation to the whole world. Look, O Lord, upon the sacrifice which you yourself have provided for your church, and grant in your loving kindness to all who partake of this one body, of this one bread and one chalice, that gathered into one body by the Holy Spirit, they may truly become a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your glory. Therefore, Lord, remember now all for a moment we offer this sacrifice, especially for your servant Francis, our Pope, and Jose, our Bishop, and the whole order of bishops, all the clergy, those who take part in this offering, those here present, those participating on live stream, and all those gathered before you, your entire people, and all who seek you with a sincere heart. Remember also those who have died in the peace of Christ, especially for Jesus, Sayas, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. We now remember and lift up to you the repose of the souls of all our fathers and our grandfathers and great-grandfathers and those who have been fathers for us, father figures in our lives who have died. And to all your children, to us, your children, grant, O merciful Father, that we may enter into a heavenly inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with your apostles and saints in your kingdom. There, with the whole of creation, free from the corruption of sin and death, we may glorify you through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will. You who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you.
Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say a word and my soul shall be healed.
My Jesus,
I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things. Desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Number 463. 463. Line number.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Renewed and nourished by the sacred body and precious blood of your Son, we ask of your mercy, O Lord, that we who celebrate with constant devotion may be our sure pledge of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I'd like to begin our announcements by offering recognition and a blessing for the fathers and father figures who are present here in church and who are also online. So if you are a father or a father figure, even if you don't have physical children, I invite you to stand. If you are a mentor, coach, teacher, certainly a father, please stand. And the rest of us, I invite you to extend your hands and bless them as I say the prayer. Good and gracious God, you showed us the importance of fathers when you chose Joseph to care for your son. Bless all the fathers who share your unconditional love with their children. Bring comfort to those fathers who have lost children or are estranged from their children, and all those who mourn the loss of their beloved fathers. Share your blessing with all those who yearn for a father's love and heal those wounded by a father's failures. Bless all men who mentor, nurture, and help children who are not their own and become fathers to children who need them. Help us, the sons and daughters of their hearts and bodies, to return their love and honor them as Jesus honored Joseph. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A round of applause for all. Some other announcements. Our Children's Faith Formation Program that teaches what we used to call CCD, teaches catechism to our children in Catholic schools, are looking for help in catechism. So adults and non-adult adults, it's a great way to share the faith that you always receive more than you get. It's so fulfilling to do that, especially with children. So if you're interested in helping out, it's going to take some time on your part, but if you're interested, please leave your name and phone number in the parish office so we can contact you and let you know what's involved. As for those teenagers who have not yet received their confirmation, we have a two-year program here, so year one confirmation registration forms are available in the parish office, as well as the week registration forms for year two. So please stop by and call the parish office, and there's more information in the bulletin today about the confirmation program. As we mentioned the last couple of weeks, the Archdiocese is asking us to contribute to the Together in Faith, the annual Archdiocese appeal that is geared specifically to help the poorer parishes and schools in our Archdiocese. So these envelopes are appeals. If you have not yet donated, if you have not donated a pledge, please take an envelope home and help with this. I know I asked you to be generous to the parish, but we also have obligations as Catholics to help those who are poor in our area, in our diocese. So please be generous and take an envelope home and bring it back next week. And next Sunday there will also be a collection for Peter's Pence. This is the Pope's personal fund to help the charities, the people that he comes across in his travels throughout the world. Again, very often, very important people in different countries. So we ask you to come prepared to give to that collection, and there will be special envelopes for that next week. As I mentioned last week, the Archdiocese has given us a new set of protocols based on the governors and the CDC's, or Centers for Disease Control, protocols as we are slowly getting through this pandemic. So I want to go over them. Our staff kind of massage them a little bit to apply them specifically to our parish. So once again, all of our celebrations, not just Mass, but weddings, baptisms, etc., there's no longer any limitations for our numbers. And as you can see, most of the church is open for seating. We're going to keep this section here going off for those who feel more comfortable still maintaining that social distancing. So that section there by the choir is going to be reserved for that. But the rest of the space is only for anybody to sit. You no longer have to sanitize your hands or take your temperature. Any of the doors of the church. So again, it's great news for us. And once again, if you are fully vaccinated, both vaccines you have received, you do not have to wear a mask in the church. You may if you want to, but you don't have to. If you are not fully vaccinated, then we ask you please to wear a mask. And if you want to sit in the section over here, that would be helpful. So again, we trust your honesty in that. And let's see. So after our weekday masses, the church doors are going to remain closed. So Monday through Thursday, they will close after 8 o'clock mass and after 6 p.m. mass. We can no longer, well, at least not for the time when we get the doors open, because we had some problems with people wandering the church during the day and leaving a mess. So we just want to avoid that possibility. On Fridays, we have adoration, so the church will be open after the 8 o'clock mass until after the evening mass for adoration. Again, we're going to continue giving communion only with the precious host, the sacred host, not with the precious blood there. Hopefully that will happen in a short while, but we're going to stick with this giving a host out, and we only will be giving communion in the hand, not on the tongue yet. But just a little bit of safety that we want to keep on following that protocol until hopefully it is removed in the near future. As for confessions, as far as we know, we're still not able to use the confessions here in church, so we have the confessions on Saturdays across the street from school, and here in church before the Spanish Mass. It's basically where Spanish people, but if you want to come at that time, that's okay too. And just so you know, we're going to continue to sanitize the church after every Mass on Sundays, but not during the week. So on Sundays, because they're just a constant flow, we want to again let you know that we're doing our best to keep the church clean, so hopefully we'll have people feel more comfortable coming to church on Sundays during the week, because the church, you know, it's going to be empty for hours at a time, and the CDC has shown that there's very little risk of receiving contamination from services, so to save us time and energy and money, not to have to disinfect during the week, but on the weekend masses, you can do that. And as well, during the pandemic, we ask those who are involved in healthcare not to participate in our ministries, in our liturgical ministries, but now you're welcome to come back if you are still even involved in healthcare, again, because the risk is much lower. Okay, those are pretty much our staff's mission. There's some other things that involve the ministries and so on. So if the ministries want to begin meeting in your groups or your prayer groups, whatever it might be, just call the parish hall to reserve the space and know what those additional protocols are. Okay, thank you so much as always for your patience and for coming to Mass today. Those of you who are here, those who are online, God bless you. And again, happy Father's Day.
Thank you, Father.